On today's program, extension entomologist Eric Rebeck helps control the aphids on our milkweed plants. We travel to a YMCA youth garden in Ponca City, Oklahoma, for the final stop in our Viewer's Garden Contest. Former host Steve Dobbs shows off some of the new historical gardens on the OSU Stillwater campus. And Barbara Brown prepares a summer corn salad. Oklahoma Gardening is a production of the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the land-grant mission of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University, dedicated to improving the quality of life of the citizens of Oklahoma through research-based information. Underwriting assistance is provided by TLC, Oklahoma's leading garden center, Southwood Landscape and Nursery, Tulsa's source for great gardens, and the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry, helping to keep Oklahoma green and growing.
Well, here we are in the tropical milkweed section of the gardens here at the OSU Botanical Gardens. And we have a slight infestation of milkweed aphids. Now, aphids are insects that have piercing, sucking mouthparts. They do belong to the group that we refer to as true bugs. And they use those piercing, sucking mouthparts to feed on the plant sap. So they're basically straw-like mouthparts, inserting those into the plant's tissue, such as the leaves or the stems, and extracting that plant sap and feeding on them. Now, aphids can be quite problematic from the standpoint that, again, they're removing that plant sap. They can cause some physiological harm to the plant. You'll typically see it reacting in terms of discoloration in the leaves or other affected plant tissue. You may even see some leaf cupping or curling as a result. And if you look closely at that area where the damage is, you'll see those very tiny insects, those aphids, feeding usually in a cluster, in a group. Aphids can get out of hand in a hurry. The females can reproduce asexually, so they can basically make exact clones of themselves, and they can they're essentially baby-making factories, and they're laying those all about behind them as they're feeding, and that population can seemingly get out of control overnight. So a few things that we can do about aphids. With the aphid management, we can oftentimes just take a garden hose and aim that at the area of the plant that's infested, and we can simply wash them off the plant. Aphids are very soft-bodied insects. They're not going to be able to climb back up onto the plant once you've washed it, once they hit the ground. Also remember, there are a lot of hungry mouths waiting for them underneath the plant on the floor of the garden. Things such as spiders and ground beetles and rove beetles and the like. So they're not going to be very likely to reinfest that plant once you wash them off. If we're thinking chemical control options, I like to recommend some of the softer chemicals, such as insecticidal soaps and horticultural oils. These act to desiccate or to smother that aphid and kill it outright. And they minimize harm for some of our good guys out in the gardens. Once again, our pollinators and our predators and our parasites, the natural enemies. There are other products we can use that are a little harder in nature. They're a little riskier to use, both for the applicator and as well as non-target organisms. And they're available on the garden shelves as well. But I always recommend physical management by washing them off with water first, followed up by insecticidal soap application or a horticultural oil. These will definitely work for managing your aphids, regardless of the plant that's affected.
Today I'm here with Chris Williams. He's the garden manager for the Ponca City YMCA garden. And right here, we're surrounded by this lovely garden. It doesn't look like a botanic garden. It looks like
no,
a kid's garden.
It is absolutely a youth garden, as you can tell. And this is August. We're at the end of our beauty, as you can see, but we still have a lot of stuff growing, and the kids are still working in the garden. It's a lot of fun here at summer camp at the Y.
Yeah, it's good to see. It's good to see a kid's garden where you know the kids are doing it. And
absolutely.
Looking at this, you could tell the kids are doing it.
Yeah.
And the kids could probably explain everything they're doing.
They can, and yeah, they have a lot of fun. Maybe we can talk to some of them here in a little bit. But you see, they're sifting dirt. They know how to do crop rotations and how important it is to sift the soil and add amendments to the soil, and we'll test the pH levels. So we're trying to teach them right.
So you didn't come into this knowing much about horticulture, did you?
Absolutely not.
So how did you decide to do it and then start?
I was asked to do it by my wife, Stephanie Williams. She's the senior program director at the YMCA. She runs the summer camps. And when your wife asks you to do something, you don't say no. I knew absolutely nothing about gardening. But with OSU and the YouTube channels and Oklahoma Gardening and the extension offices, Corbin has been fantastic in helping us. We started this 3 years ago. And every year it gets a little bit better. We learn a little bit more and we make some improvements. This will be our first year. We're going to try to not stop. And it'll be our first fall garden, so we can have an after school club come in and help us. And we'll be harvesting pumpkins in about 60 days.
So where do you get all your supplies and how do you get the funding?
A lot of it's donations. That's what we rely on so much. Our local Lowe's Home Improvement Store has given us seeds. We have Keithley's Nursery here that's been helping us out a lot. A local car dealership gave us, Pemberton Chevrolet, gave us some tools and gloves for the kids to use. So we couldn't do it without the support of the community.
And about how many kids get to use this garden year-round?
Right now we're in about 65 kids through the summer. We have little sprouts that are 5 to 10, and they got to come out two separate times for one entire week, a couple hours every morning, every day of the week. And then our Green Thumb Brigade, which is our teen group, they come twice a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays, for 3 hours each time that they come out to the garden. So they're learning a lot, and I love the discovery in the children. If anyone ever wanted to start a garden, I couldn't encourage them to do it. I mean, you've got to just, don't be afraid. It doesn't have to be pretty, just start.
And what advice would you give someone who was interested but didn't know where to begin?
Oklahoma Gardening. If you're watching the television show, you've got an interest, right? So the YouTube channels, all the go through YouTube, look up anything you want to know about. It's all there and available for you. You just got to look for it.
And you said that, when I was talking to you earlier, you said the kids choose this activity. There's other competing activities they could have chosen instead.
Yeah, absolutely. Through the summer camp program, they could do archery. They could do ceramics, they could do arts and painting, or they could choose to come and work in the garden. And it is a working garden. They don't just come and pick strawberries. They'll pull weeds, they'll plant things, and to do the fun stuff, you have to do the hard work stuff too. But it's so rewarding, and the discovery of a child to pull a carrot out of the ground for the first time and to actually taste what real food tastes like. I think we've all forgotten what food tastes like. So the kids go home, tell mom and dad, then they come back, hey, we planted a garden this weekend at home, and that's thrilling for me. It's exciting.
So do you think a lot of kids might not have known where their food came from?
Absolutely.
Until they got into
they
this?
They don't. And I'm guilty as well. I was not a veggie lover. But when you grow something from a little bitty seed, you have to try it. And I've discovered I like things that I never thought I liked before. So once you get started, it's so addictive. Everybody, you just give it a shot.
Do you have a lot of returning campers?
We do. With the program, they have what's called CITs, which is counselors in training. So those kids started out as little sprouts, and when the 3 years that I've been with them, I've been able to watch them grow and become, and now they're counselors in training, which are the lime green shirts, which are the camp staff, and then those kids will be bringing up the next generation of little sprouts. So it's a lot of fun to see.
So what do you think the kids get out of this the most?
Get out of this, we'll have to ask them.
Okay.
Here we get my skin. It's a caliper. He holds on with his butt.
He's sticky. Butterflies!
Everybody knows that.
You guys ever learn about that in the back?
I'm here with Alana and Tyler with the teen program here at the Ponca City YMCA Garden. And we just thought we'd talk to you guys about what it is you get out of this and what you like the most. What makes you come back and keep doing this?
Food? I don't know. We get to eat most of the stuff here.
What do you like to eat?
Strawberries.
The strawberries? What happens when they're not in season? What do you eat?
Cucumbers.
Is there anything you've tried new since doing the gardening?
Tabasco peppers. Don't try them.
Well, that's where they get Tabasco from. They're pretty hot, huh? And what about you, Tyler? What's your favorite part about this?
I like eating the strawberries, working here. It's pretty fun.
So what do you get out of it the most? Do you get a sense of like belonging or a sense of learning new things or?
Sense of learning new things mostly. Yeah, it's just way more fun than sitting up there in the shade and stuff.
What do you think tastes better? Grocery store food or fresh food?
Fresh food.
Do you ever just eat it without washing it off?
Yeah.
Like all the time, like,
yum. You guys like the flowers? You like the art that they made out of those old tires?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Nothing gets wasted.
Nope.
I'm here with Berna and Destiny, who are part of the teen program at the Ponca City YMCA. And I hear you guys have a really big interest in this.
Just don't, yeah, just don't.
I like seeing how food grows and what we plant from little bitty seeds.
What do you like the best?
Grow from do nothing to like something, and it's really cool how you see stuff grow.
And I heard you started a garden at your own house.
Yes, I have.
What'd you plant?
Tomatoes, potatoes, onions, a pear tree, and some flowers.
That's a lot. What's your favorite food that you've grown?
The pears.
The pears?
Yeah.
And what's your favorite food that you've grown?
Oh gosh.
Probably the peppers.
The peppers? So why do you guys like the gardening? Why do you choose the gardening instead of like the archery or the swimming? What's the big draw here?
It might sound weird, but I just like tasting it.
You like tasting it? Do you even bother washing it off or you just eat it right then?
I just eat it right then.
That's awesome.
So what do you think? You like it?
No. I don't.
I do.
Kind of tastes like ketchup.
Tastes like pure ketchup.
It is. What's your favorite part of this garden?
The bottle tree.
The bottle tree? The one thing that's not alive? Why?
It adds good decoration to it.
Oh, you get to add decoration to it?
Yeah.
What about you?
I like the corn.
The corn?
Yeah.
There's just a bunch of fun stuff too, and the staff is awesome. I mean, they're all nice. I mean, it's probably the best summer camp you could come to.
You think you'll keep coming at when after school starts?
Yeah. Especially me being a CIT.
Represent.
So you're going to do this next year?
Yeah.
And what's the favorite thing you'll think you'll take the kids out to experience? You think they'll like planting or weeding or eating? Or what do you think their favorite parts will be?
Probably the eating part.
For more information on gardening with kids, contact your local OSU Cooperative Extension office. Explore resources on our youth gardening website. Or check out OSU Cooperative Extension fact sheet HLA 6402, Children's Gardens in which to learn and grow.
Yay, gardening!
I'm on the campus of Oklahoma State University and probably one of the most photographed locations that we have. We're right here in the heart of campus in the formal garden, and you can see behind me we have the library, and probably not a visitor or student on campus hasn't walked through this garden and taken pictures. We like to surprise people with different things and have big splashes of color. And of course, over the past few years, we've been introducing topiaries into our landscape. And again, behind me, we've got topiary hat. We have a topiary boot out on campus in a different location that's been here probably 5 years. We take those in the wintertime because they're not cold hardy. But this year, we're going to introduce some new topiaries out in another location that's a color garden that will spell out OSU. And again, is live plants growing on those with long fiber sphagnum moss and drip irrigation in them, so they're really a living piece of art, if you will. And you'll see that we have an underlying theme this year, and that happens to be the 125th anniversary celebration for the university. OSU was actually established on Christmas Day in 1890, and so this Christmas will be our 125th anniversary. So in our landscape campus beautification efforts, we've been adding a few little surprises, which you'll see with the OSU topiary in that garden. But here in the formal garden, we tried a little bit of a different display and planting scheme this year, where we really spelled out images that are reminiscent of some of our history here at Oklahoma State University. You'll see a cowboy boot, and you'll see Old Central. You'll see a birthday cake and some balloons, and even a Pistol Pete head, all spelled out with plant material. The plant material that we're using is Joseph's Coat, and I think we've got probably six or seven different cultivars or colors that we're using to spell out and make the shapes. We plant them probably 4 to 6 inches apart early in the spring, and we trim them meticulously, and I've got a couple of staff members that do that, and they're very dedicated. We have a horticulturist and a student who solely take care of this garden, and so it's not uncommon for them to be out here trimming with scissor type handheld hedging shears to keep that nice, neat shape. So it's been interesting to see it evolve, and we're starting the celebration, and again, it's very festive, and we hope folks will come and take a look at this. But from a horticulturist standpoint, I always am enamored by some of the plant material that we have that makes the designs, and I've got probably two or three that I'd want to bring to your attention. One of the display gardens here that's very colorful, that doesn't really spell anything out, we're using several different plants, and of course, here at OSU, we have to have our splashes of orange color, which we add in every year. But one of my favorites is a Kufia called Vermilionaire, and it's upright growing, very full and robust. It's got little cigar-looking flowers that hummingbirds actually love, and they're a really nice orange color, and they love the heat. So the more heat, the bigger they grow. They just don't like heavy, wet soils. And then we're contrasting that plant with a silver-foliage textured one that is Cardoon. Now, a lot of people get a little bit excited about that, thinking it's maybe a thistle weed or something from a pasture, but it's actually related to artichoke. It's acts as a biennial for us, so it really won't bloom this year. If it overwintered, it would probably bloom next year, but it's got wonderful silver foliage, lots of texture, and it makes a nice companion plant with our orange and white colors. In addition to those, there's a vinca that is growing. It's low growing, and it's the Mediterranean series. It's solid white. It's kind of filling in our birthday cake. And it's very unique because one plant may grow 3-4 feet wide in a given summer. It's an annual, of course, loves the heat, but it's low growing for a vinca or periwinkle. So that's one we seem to use every year, it seems like. And then another one that we've kind of used to fill in some of the plant designs, like the boot or the Pistol Pete, is a low-growing one called Dichondra. Now, it's a little bit different species than some of the Dichondra that you might see in a lawn weed. But this one comes in two colors, silver falls as a cultivar, or an emerald falls, or an emerald green, which is the green one. And they just hug the ground and spread and grow like crazy. But a beautiful silver foliage. The silver falls grows a little bit more aggressively than the green one, but really it does a great job of filling in for us. And I think one of the most unique things at our garden is if you're here and you're wondering what these plants are, you can go up to some of the signage where there's a QR code. And if you've got a smartphone with a QR code reader, you can just go up to that sign, scan it, and it will bring up a website link that shows a picture and tells you every one of the plants that's in the formal garden. So it will help you become more aware of some of the plants that we're using that you may want to try in your own garden or landscape. Well, we invite you to the beautiful campus of Oklahoma State University here in Stillwater this fall. And we hope you'll come and check out some of these displays that we've had a lot of fun in designing and learn about all the different colorful plants, and more importantly, help us celebrate 125 years of educational success. Thank you.
today I'm going to do a summer corn salad. Now there's nothing quite like corn on the cob, but corn in the summer, sometimes if you've got your corn going, you're ready to try it a different way. So today I'm going to take it off the cob and turn it into a salad. To do that, I'm going to start with a dressing. I'm going to start with 1/4 cup of cider vinegar. Again, like always, if you've got another favorite vinegar that's not going to discolor the corn, go for it. 2 tablespoons of sugar. And a lot of us are trying to cut back on sugar, but this is a time when a little bit is going to go a fairly long way. This is actually going to serve 4 people, so it's not going to be that much per person when it comes down to it. I'm also going to add 1/2 teaspoon of kosher salt and 1/4 teaspoon of black pepper. And you're just going to whisk this around until the sugar is dissolved, and then you're going to set it aside. Now, the nice thing about this particular salad is that we're not going to cook the corn. As long as your corn is at the peak of freshness, it's good to go. So you need about 2 ears of corn. You're just going to cut the corn off the cob. I usually do that in some kind of like an 8x13 pan with a cutting board resting in it. That kind of corrals some of the kernels. There's lots of techniques for doing this. But if you don't do something to corral them, they're going to go everywhere. I'm giving you a heads up on that one. So 2 cups of fresh corn kernels. If your corn is not as fresh as you would like it, then I would blanch it for about a minute and then chill it in ice water to get it ready to go. The other thing that you could do on this, however, is if you have leftover corn that you've grilled, even though it's cooked, it adds that smokiness to this salad that's also really, really good. So 2 ears of corn is going to be about 1.5 to 2 cups of kernels. I'm going to add to that 1/4 cup of diced red onion. Now, dicing here for this particular salad, we want every piece to be about the same size as the initial pieces of corn or kernels. So look at the kernels that you've got, and before you begin to dice, that's kind of your goal. It's not all going to work out, but that's kind of the goal. I'm also going to add 1/4 cup of red bell pepper, 1/4 cup of cucumber. And I've left the seeds on because it's very pretty. I'm going to add in 1.5 teaspoons, or a little bit more depending on how much spice you like, of diced jalapeno pepper, 1/4 cup of cherry or grape tomatoes that have been halved, and just stir that together a little bit to get it underway. And then also I'm going to put in 1.5 tablespoons of chopped Italian parsley or curly parsley, whichever one you've got. And then I'm going to get some basil, and I want about 1.5 teaspoons here, so we don't need a lot. I'm just going to tear it in rather than try to cut it. It gives me a little bit more control over it for the amount I want in here, but it also keeps the leaves from turning dark quite as quickly if you tear it along the cell lines as opposed to cutting them open. So we'll get that in there and then stir that together a little bit. Then we're going to bring back our dressing. At this point, whisk this again because its sugar may have settled out of it a little bit. And just stir that in. And then this is close to being done. The last thing we're going to do is add a little bit of a green to it. And in this case, I'm going to use some baby spinach leaves. Now, I would encourage you to add this as close to the point of service as possible because we've got a lot of vinegar in here now. We've got some sugar, we've got some salt, and all of those things are going to cause the greens to break down. So get a sturdy green if you're not going to use spinach. Pick another one that is fairly sturdy. We don't need a lot in here, and we're just going to blend them in a little bit. And then rather than stir the rest in, what I'm going to do is put a few of them on the plate so there's some place for some of this terrific tasting juice to go. With a slightly larger spoon. And there you have it. This one actually serves 4, as I mentioned earlier. It's a really pleasant way to serve some of that corn as well as a lot of the other vegetables that you've got coming out of the garden this time of year. I hope you'll give it a try. It's summer corn salad. For Oklahoma Gardening, I'm Barbara Brown.
Thank you.
Next week, we will plan for cool season color by overseeding ryegrass. Former host Steve Owens joins us for a tour of the Linnaeus Garden in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We have gardening tips for October, and Barbara Brown bakes peach oatmeal bars. Join us then for more TV you'll grow to love. To find out more information about show topics, as well as recipes, videos, articles, fact sheets, and other resources, including a directory of local extension offices, be sure and visit our website, oklahomagardening.okstate.edu. And we always have great information, answers to questions, photos, and gardening discussions on your favorite social media as well. Join in on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can find this entire show and other recent shows, as well as individual segments, on our Oklahoma Gardening YouTube channel. And tune in to our OK Gardening Classics YouTube channel to watch segments from previous hosts. Oklahoma Gardening is produced by the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University. The Botanic Garden at OSU is home to our studio gardens, and we encourage you to come visit this beautiful Stillwater jewel. We wish to thank our generous underwriters, TLC Garden Centers, Southwood Landscape and Garden Center, and the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry. Additional support is provided by Pond Pro Shops, Greenleaf Nursery and the Garden Debut Plants, and the Oklahoma Horticultural Society.